history and sociology, and I want to share a story with you. 2 years ago, in the fall of 2016, I traveled from Chapel Hill to Cape Town, South Africa, to live for 6 months. I was an exchange student at the University of Cape Town, and I wrote for a small local newspaper. During my time there, I had the honor of seeing the Archbishop Desmond Tutu celebrate his 85th birthday in his home church, the enormous stone St. George's Cathedral in downtown Cape Town. It was the same cathedral where he had once led anti-apartheid rallies because it was illegal for Black South Africans to gather in large groups unless at a church service. Tutu preaches every Friday morning at 7 a.m., and his birthday was no exception. The city buses were not running so early in the morning, so I walked to the cathedral from my apartment. The sun was just rising over Lion's Head Mountain behind me. It was cold, still early spring in the southern hemisphere. I walked along the edge of the city's main park, built by the Dutch East India Company, passing under the tangled palms and jacaranda trees. All around me, I could hear the fast click of high heels from workers going in early to their offices in the business district. I walked through the wealthy Afrikaner neighborhoods on the slopes of Signal Hill, past the beautiful white stucco mansions surrounded by electric razor wire. I greeted maids and gardeners as they walked up the hill for their long days of work at these houses. Downtown, finally, I walked down Long Street towards the church, past the coffee houses and hair braiding salons and tourist shops. Though I couldn't see them, I knew that on the other side of town, crowds were pouring into the city from the minibus taxi rank, sleepy from their long commute from the townships. These all-Black townships were built in the apartheid era, when only whites were allowed to live in the city proper, and millions of non-white Cape Townians were forced from their homes to the dusty outskirts of the city. In the townships, for the most part, people still burn their trash because the city sanitation services won't pick it up. Many residents live in houses made from cardboard and tin while they await government-subsidized housing. To me, this tale of two cities was astounding, and every day it left me feeling hopeless, confused, and lost. It continues to haunt me since I've returned to the United States. At the end of Long Street, I walked into the church and heard the choir singing. And there he was, standing at the pulpit. Nobel Peace Prize winner, educator, activist, writer, theologian, former head of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, first Black bishop to hold the highest religious office in South Africa, dear friend to the Dalai Lama and Nelson Mandela, lifelong advocate for human rights. He was more petite than I had imagined. His voice was soft and warm, as if he was going to break into laughter. He wore big glasses and gold church robes with a heavy crucifix around his neck. His daughter, also an Anglican bishop, stood by his side. Bishop Tutu read from the Gospel of Mark, but that's not the part of the service I remember. At the end of his sermon, he looked up from his Bible at the crowd that had gathered for him in the pews on his 85th birthday. It was one of the only times in South Africa I remember seeing an interracial community, a true, authentic interracial community that celebrated its own diversity on its own terms. Archbishop Tutu looked out at all the friends and strangers, and he started to cry. We all stood silent in the pews while his daughter rushed up to the pulpit to comfort him. And then, suddenly, he began to laugh. It was this deep, full-bellied laugh that echoed around the walls of St. George's Cathedral. And then others in the crowd started to laugh. The old generation of whites and blacks who had helped topple apartheid, their children, their grandchildren, and even me, the nervous tourist, I began to laugh. It was like this pure sense of joy rippling through the crowd, a direct experience of the sacred. And that's what I would call hope. this sense of unspoken spiritual joy when you are in true community with others. Mr. Tutu greeted us during coffee hour after the service. He shook parishioners' hands from his wheelchair. A petite elderly man bundled in sweaters, nearing the twilight of his life. And I found myself thinking, how can he go on? How is he not exhausted and broken by the struggles of his time? I think the answer to that question is hope. Maybe it's hope which allows him to continue to be vulnerable, to not grow callous in the face of unspeakable injustice. And his vulnerability is what makes him so strong. I'd like to end my meditation on hope with the word Ubuntu. It is a word from the Zulu language, one of the 12 national languages of South Africa. In his book, No Future Without Forgiveness, Desmond Tutu talks about this philosophy of Ubuntu. He says, Ubuntu speaks of the very essence of being human. We say, hey, so-and-so has Ubuntu, which means you are generous, you are hospitable, you are friendly and caring and compassionate, you share what you have. It is to say, my humanity is caught up, inextricably bound up in yours. We belong in a bundle of life. We say, a person is a person through other people. Though Ubuntu is not exactly the same as hope, it's like hope in that it enables us to be vulnerable with each other, and that vulnerability is the basis of authentic community. In Tutu's case, that community dismantled white minority rule against all odds. Hope allowed it to happen. To hope is to say, yes, in fact, we do belong in a bundle of life. We belong to each other. Thank you.